Hello, and thank you for joining us today to learn a little bit about databot, the ultimate STEM tool for phenomenon-based science. My name is Tammy O'Connor, and I am the CEO of Educational Innovations. EI is celebrating its 28th year in business this year. We offer more than 1,000 innovative hands-on science products for use in classrooms throughout the world. Today, I'm pleased to introduce our presenter, Robert Grover. Robert and his wife, Heidi, founded the company, databot, in 2019, and EI has carried databot since its original launch, so we're delighted to have it. It's a great product. Both Robert and Heidi have been involved in STEM education for years, and using all their experience, they created this amazing tool for students. Before we get started, I wanted to mention a few housekeeping tidbits. If you have any questions along the way, please be sure to go to the Q&A section in the bottom menu of your screen and type your question in there. After the presentation and after the drawing, Robert will be answering all your questions, so be sure to stay on. Speaking of the drawing, at the end of Robert's presentation, we'll be giving away a free databot to one lucky participant, which is valued at $179.95. So please be sure to stick around because you have to be present to win. I guess it's kind of like playing the lottery, right? Now, without any further ado, Robert, please take it away.
Great. Thank you very much. Well, it is a pleasure to be here. Thank you, everybody, for joining us. I'm always excited to share the databot story with teachers. And, you know, the more people that start using it out there, the more interesting ways it's being used. This last few months, we've had it going on in a number of districts. They're actually supported by U.S. Department of Defense STEM ambassadors, and they're doing some really interesting things with math activities. They did a district-wide carbon dioxide and air quality study with students. So the more people that get a hold of this, the more innovation comes out of it, it seems like. So I'm excited to share the story with you today. We really appreciate Tammy having us today, and she's been one of our best supporters since we launched the product. So my wife, Heidi, and I are co-founders of databot. We're a US-based company. We're based out of Boise, Idaho. And we've been doing STEM education for over 30 years. We started teaching STEM before it was actually called STEM, I think. And we're teaching robotics and coding and things like that in an after-school program many, many years ago. Fast forward 30 years, we've developed lots of products. We've taught thousands of kids, and we've come up with this great idea that we felt was a much needed thing in the marketplace. And databot is a pretty interesting product because it's so versatile, and that's what we wanted. We wanted something that was small, tough, portable, easy to figure out and use, something that wasn't complicated, but something that was also capable of teaching lots and lots of things, which as I go through this presentation, I think it'll give you a pretty good idea. But it's got sensors on board. I'll actually hold one up here for you. You saw it in the initial screen, but you can see it's quite small. And, you know, it was designed to have a number of sensors and physical computing attributes built into that little package. So you could teach coding, you could teach all the core sciences, all kinds of things. Since it is so versatile, we focused on four different topic areas that we really wanted to build curriculum and support around. And those are, of course, STEAM. So that's where we get our coding, our design engineering challenges, art projects. You can actually create light and sound shows with this thing. Climate change is another one. So obviously a big issue globally, trying to get kids more familiar with environmental issues. So it does have sensors on board that make it ideal for studying the environment. Data science, data literacy, critical thinking, also huge movements globally. Of course, the entire planet is now data driven. Everything that you do, whether you're walking into a store or clicking on something on the internet, is probably logged and tracked these days. So we're doing our students a disservice if we're not preparing them for a data-powered society. And anytime they're using databot and any of the activities I'll be showing you, they're going to be developing those data literacy skills, learning how to collect data, being able to analyze it, visualize it, and use it. And then last but not least, artificial intelligence, machine learning, those also are big movements because they're the things that are coming that are now powering many things in our society. And databot actually is designed to support AI and machine learning, which I'll show you a little bit about as well in this webinar. anyway, that's a little bit about Heidi and I and how we got started. In today's webinar, we're going to cover the following things. Now, this whole presentation, Tammy's going to be able to email out to everybody afterwards, so you'll get a PDF of this. It's also being recorded, so you can go back and pick up anything that you might have missed. And of course, we love to talk about it, so just email Educational Innovations if you have questions or we didn't cover something that you're interested in, and we'll be sure to get the information back to you. Anyway, we're going to look at the kit itself that we sell. We're giving away one of those. It's $179.99 at the end of this webinar. And we'll show you exactly what goes into the kit. It's very simple, very easy to store and keep track of, but it does so much. We're going to show you how databot works. We're going to go through the sensors that are on board and the kinds of things you can explore. We're going to look at the all of the input and output on the bot that allows you to code it or do extensions or add temperature probes, things like that. I'm going to show you some activity examples. We're doing a series of sensor starters, we call them, that are great ways for you to get started with sensors in your classroom. This is designed for grades 4 through 12, and these activities are something that you can scale across that entire range. And databot has a lot of range in terms of doing things very simply or doing things, you know, much more advanced for older students. And that's one of the things that I'm very excited about. You can have these data bots in a school and you can share them amongst teachers that are focusing on completely different things, but it's very versatile. We mentioned the Visi app and the lesson plan that you're going to get to do today. So that's going to be a lot of fun. You'll actually get to do some hands-on activities with data acquisition and visualization just using the app, because it'll use the sensors on board your phone or tablet. And it's the same app that you would connect a databot with, but it allows you to actually explore the software and see how do these activities work before you were, you know, going to purchase a databot. It's a great, great way to get some hands-on experience. I will talk just a little bit about the NGSS. The fourth practice is analyzing, interpreting data. And of course, every time you're using the databot, as I mentioned, kids are becoming more data literate, more comfortable. Databot is very versatile in terms of software. So not just our app, but there are other things it connects to, which I'll give you a few examples of as well. The physical computing environment that we've developed called Data Blockly. I'll show you a screen capture from that, give you an example of how you can actually code Databot, take advantage of the sensors and the light, the sound, to actually create an environment for teaching coding using the physical attributes. We'll look a little bit at the advanced applications for machine learning and some expandability. And then, you know, if I talk really fast, we'll get to the giveaway and the kit configurations at the end. So it's a lot to cover. We'll go ahead and get started. This is what a kit looks like. And I've got one here somewhere. I'll show you the size. So this is the size of the case. The soft case has two openings in it. So you can buy it in twin packs with two in there or one. Accessories that come with each databot are a temperature probe, a lanyard, and the power and programming cable. So the external temperature probe here in the center, this is waterproof, plugs into one of the ports on the side, which I'll show you in a second, but it's something that you can drop into a beaker or a stream and use for environmental activities, as well as chemistry. Now there are two temperature probe openings on the databot, so you can have two simultaneous experiments going. Only one probe is included in the kit. If you want a second probe, because you're going to be focusing on maybe environmental or chemical type of activities, a second probe is only $10. The lanyard looks like this. I've actually got mine hooked up to a lanyard. And that comes in very handy for a lot of things. I'll show you an activity actually today using a pendulum. Okay. This just loops through the corner, so it's very easy to take off, and then you can use Databot freeform to put it on other devices or do other things with it. But the lanyard allows you to carry it around your neck. You might be able to swing it like a polo and do some acceleration experiments. And let's see, I think that's it. Oh, the Databot, of course, is also included. Anyway, very few parts, but those few parts allow you to do so many things. And we wanted to keep it simple so that there weren't a lot of parts that you would be losing or kids would need to chase. So it's very easy to track in a classroom. We even use them in remote learning environments where they get shipped out to students in the remote areas, and then they ship them back afterwards. So not too many parts to chase or lose, which is very, very important. This is a quick overview of everything that's on board databot. So this is your kind of your technical rundown, all of the different sensors. It's got both Bluetooth and Wi-Fi. I'll talk a little bit about both of those in the coming slide. It's got onboard memory, so you can write data to the app, which is what we'll demonstrate here in a moment, or you can record it all online or onto the databot itself. And you do that when you're doing offline experiments. Let's say that you wanted to put it in a rocket and launch it, and it was going to go out of range of Bluetooth. Of course, you'd want to be recording the databot data on to the bot itself. And then when you recover it, you download that data and you can analyze, you know, the flight. Let's see here. One of the things I like to point out for those of you who might be technology teachers, it's Arduino based. The Arduino ecosystem is a hardware software environment that has just tons of resources, tools, you know, free software, and all kinds of interesting experiments and projects that people have done, teachers, hobbyists, students. So Arduino is very powerful. We'll talk a little bit about that also when we get to the software, because you can actually code databot directly using the Arduino software. And then here's our list of sensors. There are a bunch of them on board, and I'm actually going to show you where they're living on the databot, so I won't go through them right now. We'll do that in the coming slides. So this slide shows you the physical design of the databot itself. So we call this home position, and home position is when you have the power port facing to the back and you're holding databot and it's pointing forward. So one of the first things we introduce students to is home position, so you know how you're oriented. And that's for XYZ coordinates, that's for doing different kinds of activities, and then also for reference, you know, on the left-hand side, since it's square, you need to know which side is left and which is right. So you always have the power port to the back. And then on the left-hand side, we'll just go around here on the databot counterclockwise so you can see what happens with each of these ports. These two are for temperature. And again, you've got a temperature probe that plugs into this port right here is number one. You'll notice that the sensors are all labeled. There's temp one, temp two. And since the case is clear, students can actually look at the board and identify where the sensors are. The sensor starter activities we do actually have students identify the location on there and tell them a little bit about how the sensor works. And then we go into how the an activity where they actually get to use it. The on-off switch is also here on the left-hand side, would be positioned about where your thumb is if you're holding it. And it's built into the case. So it's a little plastic lever that you depress. It'll click the switch on or off, one click on, one off. And the entire case is perfectly smooth, so there's no protuberances. The switch doesn't stick out or something that you can snag on. We did that on purpose. This is the second version of databot, so we've actually improved a number of things in version 2 from version 1. And a lot of the people that used version 1 in the field had great feedback. That's why we ended up with 2 temperature probe ports, for example. So the next port here is your power and programming. And then I like to point out the physical computing attributes here. We've got 3 red circles that are highlighting the RGB LEDs. So these are codable. You can program them to be any color you want. You can code them to be solid, to blank. You can do all kinds of fun stuff in the programming environment. And then we use those LEDs also for indicators. So you'll know when your databot is charging, you'll be able to know what mode it is in, those kinds of things. In addition to the light output, you've got a microphone here. So you've got the ability to take sound in and get sound intensity readings. And then you've got sound out. That's what the tone generator is for. So that's where you can come up with your light and sound show. You can code the databot to play, you know, different songs. I had one student actually code it to play the Piano Man. It was very interesting. That's in a video online. So that's a fun one. That's a great engineering challenge, is to teach somebody, you know, how you basically change the variances in the frequency and tone and duration, and have them actually create songs. Very challenging. These last two ports are for extensions into other systems. So for those of you, again, who might be technology teachers, you'll probably be familiar with I2C or UART, which is a serial protocol. These are communications protocols for connecting to other devices. and you can connect them to other robotic systems. So for example, you can connect them into the Sphero rover. It has an I2C port that you'd be able to connect the two. You can connect it to Lego. You can connect it to Fisher Technic, Vex. You know, we've designed it to be open enough that you can, hopefully, if you've got a good technology program going, you should be able to figure out a way to hack into it. We provide the pinouts, all of the addressing, everything you would need, for example, to even connect it to a breadboard and do activities like that. So that's a quick tour of Databot anatomy. Let's go on to the actual sensors themselves. So we've got a number of sensors on board. We packed a lot onto this one PCB. So you've got a proximity sensor, it's called time of flight, and it bounces a signal off of an object and then times the amount of time from sending the signal to receiving it back and then calculates the distance. That's good for up to about 2.5 meters, okay? And you can use that for lots of physics type projects. So you can use it for calculating speed, for example. One of the things that we've had a lot of people interested in doing lately are drone activities. So we've got another activity with a drone, for example, where you're using that proximity sensor. This is a Databot mounted to a tello. And you bounce the signal off the ground as you fly the tello in a straight line. And you would be able to take that data map and actually, you know, determine your elevations beneath you as you were flying and try to create a terrain. So lots of fun activities that you can do just around that one. We've already talked about the probe. That's where they go. And that's what they look like. Air pressure and altimeter, that's in this component right here. And of course, air pressure is used to calculate your altitude. So it's a great teaching tool for introducing students to, you know, air pressure. You know, we have air on us all the time. It's something we take for granted. And it's really interesting when students start studying air pressure and they realize, wow, I've got hundreds and hundreds of pounds of air resting on me. And you can use Databot to actually demonstrate that in some really interesting ways. The altimeter is calculating altitude based on air pressure. And it's accurate enough that you can have students run up and down stairs, for example, and then actually calculate the height of the stairs based on the change in air pressure. So there's a lot of interesting things you can do with that. UV index, let's see, that's right here. So that allows you to introduce concepts about ultraviolet radiation. And you can talk about things like the electromagnetic spectrum. Also great for just teaching kids about safety in terms of exposure to the sun. The humidity is right here. So another environmental sensor. Sound, I pointed out, there's your microphone. The accelerometer, gyro, magnetometer, those are all fantastic for physics activities, right? And those live right here in the center. That's called an IMU, inertial measurement unit. And all of those little sensors live in that one spot right in the middle, which is very useful if you're spinning it like a top or things like that. The air quality sensor is over here. That's where we get our carbon dioxide, volatile organic compound levels. And then finally, this module here is for ambient light. It also gives you readings in color, has a gesture sensor, so it'll detect if you're going left or right over the Databot or forward or back. So that's one of the fun things that you can integrate into your coding activities. And then finally, there's another proximity sensor on board. It's a very small one, close range one. It's basically the same type of sensor that is in your cell phone. And again, that would be one that's used for coding. So very quick, we'll move on. It's now time to learn about Visy. And this is how we use Databot out of the box. Now I mentioned it's got lights that show you what mode it's in. When you first turn Databot on, if you're holding it upright like so, it's gonna come on with a little flashing blue light. And you'll see that highlighted here. And that is essentially Visy mode, okay? And Visy out of the box is the simplest way to use Databot. You can literally be up and collecting data in 60 seconds, and that includes installing the app. And I've actually timed teachers doing that. But this is what it looks like when you scan in activities. So it'll give you icons that you click on. When you open them up, all the experiments are pre-configured with your sample rate, everything. So they're very easy to use for students and quick. So here's a couple of examples of activities that you can do with Visy, and then we're actually going to install it and play with it a little bit. So this one is an example of how distance from your light source is going to affect intensity, right? So you can actually take readings on, when we did it with kids, we would lay out a centimeter rule, and then you would actually have them take data readings at, you know, right up next to it, 20 centimeters away, 40, 60, 80, 100, and watch what the light intensity does. So at a younger level, you can just talk about, okay, intensity is getting less as we go away. Higher level activities. One of the math teachers I mentioned is actually doing an activity around this that is introducing students to the inverse square law, because the data that you collect from this directly correlates to a math function that he wants them to understand. So that's a great way to use it as applied math. This one I mentioned earlier, this is the pendulum activity, just using your lanyard. And what you do is you're going to take potential energy, of course, and you're going to convert it to kinetic. And you can see very clearly in the data that's displayed there that the energy is dissipating and getting less and less as it accelerates less and less. So the question, of course, is where does the energy go? This is a great activity for the law of conservation of energy, because we know that energy is not created or destroyed, but obviously it's disappearing here. Where is it going? And you can have challenge kids to try to figure that out. Of course, it's going to be air resistance. It's the friction where it's swinging here against my fingers, but a great hands-on activity that's really accentuated by data and very simple to do. A couple more simple activities. This is a fun one with volatile organic compounds. You trap databot inside a small container with some vinegar, and you can actually record the VOCs that are off gassed from vinegar. So VOCs, of course, volatile organic compounds, are substances that they evaporate at room temperature. So things like gasoline or cleaning materials, things that you can smell in the air that have a chemical smell to them. If you walk into your garage and you smell gasoline, for example, good example of VOCs. Now, VOCs are also emitted from carpet, from furniture that might have just been recently varnished, paint in your walls. So you can do a lot of activities with students, just introducing them to potential hazards in their environment by teaching them how to hunt for VOCs. And this is a really good example here where you actually see VOCs being produced and the data that's generated. This is a fun reverse of that. You take the vinegar out of the jar and you put baking soda in and seal it up again. Let it stabilize a little bit and then take the readings again, and you'll notice that the reaction with the volatile organic compounds in the air and the baking soda is literally scrubbing those VOCs from the air. So students can learn a little bit about chemical formulas, chemical interactions, and also some cool challenges about, hey, how do we clean the air when we pollute it? All right, so now it's time for the app itself. So, you should, if for those of you who are able to do this, you can always do it later too, if you're watching this on your phone or something, because we will pass this out. And Tammy's also gonna send out a complete curriculum unit called the Ninja Walk, which is what these experiments are related to. That is something you'll be able to do with your students in your classroom right away. You can do it just with a smart device, because we're gonna be using the accelerometer that's built into your phone or tablet. Now, the app itself is called Vizzy, V-I-Z-E-E-Y, and that's for visualization, visualizing data. And if you look it up on your App Store or Google Play, you should see a very colorful little V show up there, and that's the app you're looking for. Go ahead and download it. And I'll give everybody just a minute or so to go ahead and download it. If you are having technical problems, don't worry about it. We can make sure you get up and running after the webinar. But once you get it downloaded, and we literally have timed this, it's 60 seconds to get installed and typically up and running, unless we've got a super slow internet connection. But go ahead and install Vizzy. It's going to come up with a blank screen with just the Vizzy logo. And once you see that, that's when we get to actually scan in our first set of activities. And this is one of the things I like to point out about Vizzy and how easy it is to use. We use QR codes or links to just bring those experiments pre-configured into your device. So you don't have to worry about that. You don't have to have the students configuring the data unless you want to, you know, at a later stage. So we try to make it really easy for the experiments to be ready to go, ready to teach. So anyway, you're going to be looking for the plus sign on your screen. Like on my Visi screen capture here, you'll notice it's down here in the lower right-hand corner. I think that's Android. If you have an iPhone, I think it's in the upper right-hand corner. But anyway, tap on that and look for the option to add an experiment from the QR code. And then it'll bring up a little scanning window. And that's when you scan this QR code, which is our Ninja Walk activities, which are a lot of fun. We'll wait one more minute for everybody. Once you've got it installed and you've scanned that, you should see these activities over here on the left. It'll say Ninja Physics Smart, which is referencing your smartphone, smart device, since we're not using the databot. We have Ninja Physics also using a databot, so you can do it remotely with the databot in your hand. But you should have four activities that have been scanned in here. We call these experiments. The little dots on the right-hand side allow you to delete them. So you can keep a nice clean interface. If you want to bring in five or six experiments that you just want those kids to focus on, you can get rid of all the other noise and just use those. Anyway, we're going to start by tapping on 3D Basics, and it's going to come up with this screen that looks like this. You'll see a little arrow at the top of the screen that you'll want to tap on. It's either going to be displaying a pause sign if it's running or an arrow if it's not running. So to start the experiment, you tap on that. And when you tap on that, you're going to actually see something similar to the numbers that you see there. And what you're seeing is acceleration due to gravity. So you've got an X, Y, and a Z axis. And the way that the IMU is oriented in there, if you hold your phone straight out in front of you, okay, and the axis going through the phone like this is the Z axis, all right? Your IMU, the little chip in there, is laying flat. So right through the center of that chip is your Z axis. And if you hold it flat in your hand, you should be able to get it close to 9.8 meters per second squared, which of course is acceleration due to gravity. And this is a great introduction to, first of all, acceleration due to gravity. After you do this series of activities with Ninja Physics, kids will never forget 9.8 meters per second squared because they've been staring at it, you know, for a number of activities, which is a lot of fun. The first part of this, you know, we're introducing them also to XYZ coordinates. So you're learning a little bit about three-dimensional coordinates. So just doing this simple freeform experiment, again, holding it like so is your Z-axis. Now go ahead and challenge yourself to try to get a perfect 9.8 meters per second squared on the Y-axis, which is going this way through your phone. Okay. And then if you rotate it, you're going to get the X-axis. Okay. So you got Y, you got X, and you've got Z. So a great way to introduce 3D coordinates to kids and actually get them, you know, focused on something very simple, like, hey, can you hold that thing perfectly level at 9.8 meters per second squared? The other activities in this series, you'll get the lesson plan and you'll actually be able to do these with your students. They're a lot of fun. They introduce the concept of acceleration as well as acceleration due to gravity. And I'll just tell you real quickly, smooth walker, for example, you're holding it, you're trying to maintain movement for 10 seconds and maintain a perfectly zero acceleration. So kids will actually be able to see the data and they'll realize, hey, I can be moving and have no acceleration. How is that? So anyway, the final one wraps all of that up where you're working with gravity, you're working with acceleration of your own body, and you're trying to navigate a course called the Ninja Walk. So the activities we create, we try to make these very interactive in terms of getting kids physically engaged with data using the sensors. And DataBot, of course, lends itself very nicely to that because it's so small. I like to emphasize too that it's tough as nails. People are always worried about it getting dropped, and it does get dropped a lot, but we launched it on rockets. We put it in Nerf footballs. You're of course gonna wanna pad it a little bit. One of my STEM ambassadors had a catapult session with kids, and they discovered that, oh, hey, we probably should pad it a little bit because when they were launching it against a hard tile floor, you know, 20, 30 feet, it wasn't doing so well. We had to replace a few of those. So it's not you know, we don't encourage you to throw it at a brick wall, but you can do a lot of fun experiments if you pad it appropriately with like some bubble wrap and things like that. And we've got some hints for you to do that. So now I'm going to give you an example of a of curriculum. So we have a number of activities called sensor starters. There are 14 of these sensor starters. Each one introduces, you know, a different sensor and provides you with a couple of activities. So for those of you who've never done sensor activities or worked with probeware, this is a great way to get started because we introduce you to, first of all, the sensor itself, where it lives on the databot, the units that it's measuring in, what exactly is it measuring? So for example, acceleration, teaching kids, just like we were talking about, acceleration is changes in speed or direction, okay? And you can actually measure that. Anyway, the first part of each one of these, they're just 2 pages long. They include a code just like we did here a moment ago. In fact, if you scan that code, it should bring in the set of experiments you need to do this particular sensor starter if you had a databot. So there are 2 activities. Total, those 2 activities take 15 minutes and they introduce students to whatever that particular sensor is, and also some concepts about, you know, what that sensor's reading. So in this case, again, acceleration. This one, for example, is a very fun activity. After they learn how to read the actual display, we have them actually do an activity where they try to get the highest level of acceleration. And this is linear acceleration. It's combining the amounts from all 3 axes into one value. Try to get them to generate the highest value possible as they hold the databot tight to their body. Now, if you're swinging it or things like that, you can get a much higher value easier. But if you're holding it tight to your body, it's only going to be how fast you can jerk, jump, run, hop. And it's a lot of fun because everybody, of course, is trying to figure out, okay, how can I accelerate faster? How can I get a higher value? So those are the kinds of activities we do. Again, this particular sensor starter and all of these you can do in 15 minutes in your class. And they're great for accentuating existing activities you're doing. Whenever you do them, you're going to be reinforcing data literacy concepts and teaching these kids how to gather data, interpret data, work with data. So let's see, we've got a few more minutes. The NGSS, I always like to highlight. I just mentioned that, of course, anytime you're doing anything with DataBot, you're teaching students how to interact with data. And that's what the fourth practice is. There are 8 practices as part of the national the next generation science standards. And the practices, the fourth one is all about data. So again, anytime that you're doing activities with DataBot, simple or complex, you're reinforcing that ability to actually use data. So very important. All right, quick introduction to another mode. And I'm gonna be fairly quick on these just so I can give you the lowdown on a lot of different things. But server mode is when we turn it on in a different position. So for example, I'm gonna turn it on when I'm holding it on upside down. And hopefully you can all see that on my screen. It's now flashing green instead of blue. And what that means, it's in server mode, which allows you to connect to it as a Wi-Fi network, and you can pull up and control dashboards with it using your browser. So for example, this is a drone dashboard that you can pull up. And I mentioned we have a lot of people starting to use it with drones. These are different missions. So for example, you would select your mission by clicking on the little box here. You hit start mission, it'll start recording the data. You run the mission. When you come back, you download the data and you have students analyze it. Couple of examples of drone activities, putting out pads. Some of them have magnets underneath them and they represent iron ore deposits. Okay, so you're using your magnetometer to fly over this field and identify iron ore deposits for mining. Etch-a-sketch is like the proximity sensor I mentioned. So trying to determine terrain as you fly over it with a drone. Seeking green, identifying different environmental states by using your color. So for example, can you determine the difference between grass and asphalt and dirt by just flying your drone over those areas and using the color sensor? Anyway, lots of things you can do with server mode. We have different dashboards. One is an environmental dashboard for your classroom. I think I have one running here on my tablet that I'll just show you. There we go. And again, this is what an environmental dashboard looks like. So that one is reading the values in my office, air quality values, temperature, things like that. And that's all real time, of course. So you're communicating with Databot as a server. It actually acts as a little web server. So for, again, you technology teachers out there, there's some fun things you can do with that as well. Quick summary of other platforms and other software. So you can code this thing with the Arduino platform. You can code it with DataBlockly, which I'll show you here in just a few minutes. You can also connect to Excel directly. That's a really interesting practice, actually. Microsoft has a hacking STEM group within their company that develops some free STEM resources for teachers. One of the things they developed was this add-in called DataStreamer, and it allows you to connect to live data sources like Databot. So we can actually stream environmental data, for example, into Excel, and you can build your own little dashboard that shows, you know, the air quality in your classroom just using Excel. So a great application of that particular software. Anyway, it's very versatile. We designed it again so that you would be able to hack it and make it your own if you're a technology teacher. Now, our coding software is called DataBlockly, and I've got just a simple program up here to show you how that works. This is a drag and drop environment. Of course, you can see over here, you've got your logical operators, your math, all of the sensors live in this menu. And this is a very simple program that gives you an idea of how you can tie the sensors and the sensor values to the physical output. So you can see here, we're reading the CO2 sensor, and we got a simple if-else statement. So if the value of CO2 is above 1,000 parts per million, and the CO2 sensor starter actually shows you all that you need to know about CO2 values. You know, it's, you know, your typical classroom should be around 400 parts per million if you've got good HVAC. You could actually do a study in your classroom to see, you know, can you tell when all the students come in, you know, because your CO2 levels, of course, go up when you have 30 people come into the classroom and they start to breathe. Anyway, if it gets above 1,000, you know, you're starting to get into less quality air. When you get above, you know, 4,000, you're in very hazardous air. But here we're using the lights to demonstrate basically, are you in a safe environment or not? So it looks at the if statement here. If CO2 is above 1,000, turn on the red light, starting to get a little bit hazardous. If it's not, then just keep it on green. So it will be green constantly unless you get above that level. And of course, kids can puff on it and it'll turn red so that you can see the elevated CO2 levels. That's a very simple example of using a drag and drop environment to code Databot. And the just physical logistics behind that, you create your code, you download it to Databot. Databot will remember that code. And that's actually another mode in Databot. So I showed you server mode. If I turn Databot on button side up, you'll notice it flashes the little lights. That means it's in code mode. So now you can program it. And it'll remember whatever your program is that you last downloaded to it when you bring it up in code mode. It's easy to switch from mode to mode. And last, we've got just a couple minutes left here, and then we're going to do the giveaway. A couple more slides. One of these is just advanced applications. So Databot is built on what's called an ESP32 processor platform. And it's something that you can actually use as what's called an edge computing device. So for teachers who might be doing advanced computer science activities, doing machine learning, for example, you can use the TensorFlow environment to create these machine learning models and then actually download them to Databot as an edge computing device. So you can use all of those sensors and develop different models that, you know, you might want to be putting out on the network and using as an application for teaching students. Let's take a look at the next one here. This is the expansion system. I like to point out that there are a number of sensors in the Arduino world that are quite inexpensive, but allow you to extend the capabilities of Databot. We've designed a cable that is an interface cable for a system called the Grove system. and Grove is available on the internet. They're low cost sensors, like their pH sensor, is $17, the formaldehyde sensor, this little water level sensor is $7. Anyway, it gives you the ability to add on capabilities. We'll be releasing more information about the add-on cable this summer. A lot of the, due to supply chain problems, unfortunately, a lot of the Grove sensors are not available right now, but they're going to be coming back. So just to give you a little heads up, there's some really fun things that you'll be able to do with those once they're back available. So this slide just summarizes what we've just talked about. It's one device. As I mentioned when we first started the webinar, it's super versatile. I've gone really fast and shown you a lot of things, so I know it's a lot to take in. But you know, generally the thing to remember is this databot is, it's designed to be super easy to use out of the box, so don't be intimidated by it. That was one of the chief goals of the product itself, is take it out of the box, turn it on in busy mode, connect to it, and you're immediately doing these activities and able to interact with sensors and the environment around you. So that's the way that 90% of our users use it. For those people who are doing technology programs, teaching coding or engineering design challenges, it's got all kinds of capabilities for doing that. But if you're just interested in having something fun for your classroom that actually gets students interacting with data, you know, 2-3 times a week, in a very fun way, this is a great way to do it. These are the product configurations, and very simple again. So the case that I showed you, you can purchase these as singles. This is what Tammy's about to give away. And that includes the databot and one set of accessories. Twin packs, 2 bots per case and 2 sets of accessories. So, you know, one of the things we were trying to do is make sure that this doesn't take up a lot of room in your classroom. So they're easy to store. And easy to share and things like that. The last thing is a class pack is 5 of these twin packs, which gives you 10 to use in your classroom. And if you do groups of 2 or 3, it works very well. We have some districts that are using them on a one-to-one basis, you know, where you've got one databot paired with an iPad, but lots of ways to use them. They also work with Chromebooks. I'll mention a lot of people are using Chromebooks out there. That app, Visi, you can download to a Chromebook and test it and see it as well. And with that, I think I've used up my time. I'm going to stop talking and I'll turn it back over to you, Tammy.
Okay, Robert, that was terrific. Thank you so much. So we've gotten a couple of questions, both in the Q&A. Some I've actually been able to answer on my own. I'm pretty impressed. And others came through the chat. So we'll go through those in a minute. But before we do that, we're going to give away the single databot. And so while we were shuffling up the names for the people that we have here, and the winner of today's databot is Joseph Romero. So congratulations, Joseph. I'm sure that you and your students are just going to be delighted with this new addition to your classroom. I will be in touch. I will email you, and we'll get your address and figure out how to get this over to you. For those of you who would like to stick around for some the Q&A portion of this presentation, that would be terrific. I'll start with the Q&A down from the bottom, and then we'll also go through the chat. I don't know, Robert, if you can see the chats, but so the first. The first question that we had is, and I know that there are, but are there any databot tutorials online? And if so, where?
Yes. So the if you go to databot.us.com/start or setup, it'll take you right to the setup manual and tutorials of how to set up Visi, the manuals. That's where you're going to find the sensor starters. If you go to, I'm trying to remember what the link is called, but it's on the left-hand side there. Yeah, there's a lot of information, including all of the data sheets and the technical information I mentioned. So for those of you who are Uber geeks, every possible bit of information you might be interested in about the sensors are there.
Okay, and the second question is, what file format are the data file and databot outputs?
So out of Visi, you can export in Excel, or I think there's 3 different CSV formats, so comma separated values. pretty standard exports. And the way that you share them out of Visy, super easy. You basically go to a little three-dot menu when you've got your experiment running. In fact, if you've installed the app, you can do it yourself. Whenever you're hitting that play icon and it's displaying data like we did with when we were looking at gravity, it's recording. You can hit pause, go to the little three-dot menu that's right next to there, and it's going to give you an export data option. And when you select that, whatever export, whatever communication capabilities are activated in your device will be ways you can share it. So you can text the data to yourself, you can email it to somebody, you can download it. It makes it very easy to get the data from Visy into other applications that you might be using.
Okay. Another question is, can the sample rate be changed? Can it be used with a time-lapse mode?
Yes. So in the server mode that I mentioned, there's the very first screen that comes up. It's your sensor configuration menu for offline experiments. It allows you to select which sensors you want and the sample rate. So good example that I always give teachers of how to use that is to do an environmental study over the course of a week. So select your CO2 levels, your humidity, your ambient light, volatile organic compounds, and set your sample rate to 5 minutes. So take samples over the course of a week, every 5 minutes, and then have the students actually analyze the data. And you should be able to see, during the weekdays when classes are coming in and out, because you're going to see CO2 levels changing. At the end of the day, you'd be able to see when the cleaning crew comes in, because your VOC levels will probably go up as cleaning chemicals are brought out. Fun stuff like that. But yes, those are completely configurable. The Visy experiments also can be configured. We can create specific experiments that have specific sample rates if you're looking for something that you can't do in the configuration mode I just mentioned.
Righty. And then we have a question from Susan saying, how far away does the Bluetooth work?
It'll depend on your Bluetooth device that you're connecting it to. We haven't tested the range on version 2 yet, but with version 1, we were able to connect to the device like a football field away with some devices, and some devices were only half that. Chromebooks were very short range, but easily within a classroom. So it should work well within a classroom. If you go outside, then you're probably going to, you'll have to experiment and see what your device does.
All righty. And then we have a question that says, is by installing the databot on the bottom of the tello, would we interfere with the tello's height sensor?
No, when you do that, you'll notice that we've got it mounted so that the sensors are clear. And then the other way to mount this on your tello, we have a 3D printable attachment. It clips on here and databot will ride up above the props. So you can use that as well. So I use this for down mounted experiments, like the one I was describing with the magnetometer or the proximity sensor. But let's say you want to do air quality or other environmental studies, you can mount it above by using that little clip-on model. And we share the 3D printable file so that you can create your own snap-on attachments.
All right. And Katrina says, I wish there was a way students could connect via their classroom computers, as we don't allow any phone devices for classroom use. Suggestions? I think that you mentioned.
Yes, if you've got Chromebooks, Visy will run on that. That's about the only thing. Windows is supposed to be able to run Android apps now, and we're looking at trying to get it running on Windows, but that's your only other option other than using the different software that I mentioned. So you can use Arduino or you can use things like Excel. It would just depend on what software you've got available to you.
Okay. And someone is looking to do some sound experiments and wants to know if you can attach the databot to a drone and have it hover over a crowd to collect decibel levels. What's the max height the drone could fly and still record accurate data?
That's an interesting question. I mean, the databot will record data as high as you can take it. We have people send it up in high altitude weather balloons. At a certain point, you know, you hit a temperature level where the sensors shut down, which you can look up in the data sheets. And the people who are doing high altitude launches typically are putting them inside little insulated containers. But your drones, you know, you can easily do like an air column experiment where you fly, let's say you're using a Mavic and you go up 300 feet. You can take data readings all the way up of air quality, sound, humidity, carbon dioxide levels. I don't know if I've answered your question, but it'll read data consistently at any elevation until at least you get a freezing point where the whole thing shuts down.
All right. And our last question is a question to you, Robert. Have you ever met or collaborated with David Vernier?
You know, I have not. I talked to the new CEO of Vernier a few years ago, and we chatted about, you know, what we're doing, what they're doing. You know, we have a little bit different approach. We're trying to create things that are you know, much more appropriate for elementary and middle school, and things that are extremely accessible. You know, they do fantastic products in terms of especially rigorous, you know, lab grade equipment that you're using at the high school level, and you're doing, you know, planned experiments. We look at databot as a much more exploratory tool, you know. You know, it's all about phenomenon these days. So let's say that you have a question you want to pursue. You can literally do data studies with Databot in seconds. You can grab it, turn it on and say, what's going to happen here? You know, take it out and do carbon dioxide levels in the parking lot, or you smell gasoline in the garage. Can you track down the source of volatile organic compounds using Databot? Those kinds of things. So they're really positioned differently. Both great products, I will say.
when I was teaching middle school, I used Vernier, and I have to say that I'm no longer teaching, of course. But when we go out and we present at shows and whatnot, Databot is a huge hit with teachers, and I'm very much looking forward to continuing our relationship. Here we just had another question come in. Is there a force sensor that can be used?
A force sensor, or you can use the accelerometer for recording forces. So for example, acceleration and deceleration, we've done like, you know, the egg drop challenge with Databot. If you're talking about like a pressure sensitive sensor, you know, something where you're trying to determine the force of something pressing down on it, those are available in the GROW system. So you would be able to attach one of those, yes.
Okay, I think that's it. I think all of our questions have been asked and answered. We will be sending out the recording for this. And as Robert said, if you have any questions at all, please don't hesitate to ask. You can respond to the email that you get, or email us at info@teachersource.com. And it was great having you all. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Robert. Take care.
Bye.